So when we look at the functions of proteins, there's many, many different functions within a cell. I'm just going to go over a brief overview of some of them. So proteins can be used to build structures. They're really important in muscle tissue, in hair, fingernails, building those kinds of structures. The other really important thing they can do is act as enzymes, and enzymes are chemicals that will speed up chemical reactions without being used up in those reactions. So they can help control the rate of chemical reactions in our body. And we will talk more about enzymes and how they work in a later lecture. Proteins are going to be involved in transporting other molecules. Things like lipids that don't dissolve well and need to move through the bloodstream are often carried by proteins. Our immune response, later when we talk about the immune system, you're going to see proteins involved as antibodies and reacting to embedded proteins in the membrane. The key for all of these functions is the order of amino acids. So the order of amino acids determines the three-dimensional shape, which in turn determines the function of the protein. And I use a lot of goofy examples in this class, and hopefully this visual will make sense. But imagine I have a string of beads that is in a very specific order where some things are hydrophilic and some are hydrophobic. I dunk that into some water, and when I pull it out, I have something that is turned into the shape of a hammer. And I can use that to hammer nails, etc. I take another order of beads, different order, dip it into the same water, and I come out with something the shape of a saw. The order of amino acids determine the shape, but the shape is different, and now it will function to cut things apart, but not help put them together. So that's sort of the idea with the order of amino acid. The order gives you different shapes, which leads to different functions. And a good way to see an example of this is to see when it goes wrong and we lose a particular function. So there's a disease called sickle cell anemia where red blood cells have hemoglobin proteins that can't carry as much oxygen as they're supposed to. The hemoglobin protein has about 148 amino acids, and if there's an error in just one of those amino acids, it changes the shape of the protein enough that it can't carry as much oxygen. And it actually affects the shape of the blood cell itself. So here you can see normal, healthy red blood cells. Here are these sickle-shaped red blood cells, and this gets its name, the disease gets its name from this shape. Notice out of 148, we have a change in just one amino acid, but that changes that overall shape enough that you end up with this disease. So we can see if you change the structure of a protein, you're going to change the function of the protein. So our third kind of macromolecule are the nucleic acids, DNA and RNA. So unlike proteins, where there's thousands of different kinds of proteins, and carbohydrates, where there's seven or eight different kinds of carbohydrates, nucleic acids, there's only two, DNA and RNA. The structure of DNA and RNA, the monomer is a nucleotide. The nucleotide is made of three parts, a sugar ring, a phosphate ring, and a nitrogen base ring. And all three of these are attached to each other. The sugar and the phosphate rings bond together, so each monomer is a sugar phosphate bonded to the next monomer, sugar phosphate bonded to the next sugar phosphate. And then coming off the sugar are these nitrogen bases, and they just sort of hang out from that long chain. The sugar ring and the phosphate ring is the same for every nucleotide, but there are five possible nitrogen bases, so those can vary: adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, and uracil. And they're often referred to just by their first letter as A, G, T, C, and U. So DNA has two strands of these nucleotides held together by matching nitrogen bases. So you've got a long chain of sugar phosphates with A, T, C's, and G's hanging out, and then their matching base pair will hold them to another strand. So A always bonds with T, G always bonds to C. RNA is single-stranded, and so the nitrogen bases are not bonded to anything. We can look at a picture of this. Here you can see DNA has the double strands. You don't actually see the sugar phosphate rings because they're just repeated. They're drawn as sort of an ongoing ribbon here. And then each base is bonded to another base, and you can see by the colors, adenine is always bonded to thymine, and guanine is always bonded to cytosine. RNA is a single-stranded backbone with the nitrogen bases unpaired. There is one more difference. You notice that RNA has uracil but no thymine, and DNA has thymine but no uracil. When we look at the function of DNA and RNA, DNA is going to be the code to build all the proteins. So we said that a protein is an order of amino acids folded into a three-dimensional shape. Well, who determines what order those amino acids are in? That's the DNA. The DNA is also going to carry instructions from the parent to the offspring. The RNA function, there's several different kinds of RNA. Messenger RNA, transfer RNA, rRNA are just three that we're going to learn about. There's actually more than that. And their job is to work together to carry out DNA's instructions and actually build the proteins. So DNA has sort of the overall idea of what needs to happen. RNA does the heavy lifting. So here we have a piece of DNA. The DNA is going to get transcribed into RNA, and then that RNA will be translated into an order of amino acids, which is a protein. And we will spend more time on this concept in chapter 9. And here's a quick summary of the structure and function of DNA.